So actually, maybe it's not a military title. It's, as you will see, it's a, let's say some kind, it's a way how to solve some very fundamental problem of propagation of light pulses in any medium, actually. So actually, I would propose some outline of my talk, which is half is devoted to, let's say, simplified physics, just to know what is the problem here. And as you will see, the problem is very fundamental. And so the solutions are very, I would say, very interesting and sometimes quite unexpected. And the result is unexpected as well. So actually, I will start with what is the diffraction and dispersion of pulsed laser beams. So it means that we will talk about the very short laser pulses, which are, and the laser beams, which are focused to very tiny dimensions. And actually, what is the way how to produce light bullets? They can be produced both in linear regime as well as nonlinear. So actually, my talk will be, of course, more dedicated to nonlinear effects. So therefore, will be some short introduction on the nonlinear index of refraction of materials, of transparent materials, and what effects are produced by this. And so going well then to some phenomenon or some propagation, specific propagation regime of very short light pulses and intense light pulses in transparent dielectric media, which is called femtosecond filamentation. And we end up with spatiotemporal light bullets, which could be generated in any transparent dielectric medium. So to start with, the problem is that what we think is a laser beam, but when you have an ultra-short laser pulse, actually the energy is localized within a small volume, which is defined by a beam diameter of a laser beam and pulse duration of a pulse. So actually, you have all this energy which is emitted by a laser, which is contained in a very small volume. It could be made very small. The problem is, as this pulsed laser beam propagates in any dispersive medium, so it spreads out. So actually, its temporal and spatial dimensions increase with propagation. And so there are two fundamental effects which cause that spreading. This is diffraction. So this is in space domain, and so dispersion in time domain, which cause the beams to spread. So what is the diffraction? So and why the laser beams are spreading in space as they propagate? Because usually we think that the laser beam actually is the beam which propagates quite a long distance without any spreading. Of course, there is a spreading there. If you have beam which is large enough, okay, there is, you can neglect the diffraction spreading, so you can transmit the beam to very, very large distances, some tens of meters, kilometers, and so on and so on. So, and if the beam is millimeter, centimeter diameter, so it's quite large. And so in the laboratory frame, you can neglect this effect. But actually the problem is if you have a beam which is tightly focused, let's say you have the beam diameter of around 10 microns, so the diffraction spreading is very fast. And this is because the diffraction is a consequence of the uncertainty principle of a photon. So the better you know localization of a photon in space, so you don't know its momentum. So you don't know the direction of its momentum. So this means that if you have a tightly focused beam, so you have a propagation direction, could be anything which is in some angle. And this angle is increases when you decrease dimensions. You increase dimensions, so actually you are approaching the plane wave, so where all vectors are parallel. And so what happens then? So for a Gaussian beam, so we can just, it's from a Gaussian beam optics, so that's very simple. So you can write a formula and say, okay, the Gaussian beam will expand according to the law which is written here, and this is a typical length over which the diameter of a laser beam increases by a factor of a square root of 2, is called a diffraction length or Rayleigh range. So how this effect is crucial for small dimension beams? So this is a picture which shows you how a beam of which has a radius of 10 microns, how fast it diffracts with propagation in some, let's say, medium, which is a fused silica, for instance. also there is a function of wavelength. So we can see that the beam dimensions are almost doubled just after 1 millimeter of propagation. So this is very fast. Another is a dispersive broadening, so-called. It is because if you have a short pulse, which is, has a broad spectrum, so it's composed of many spectral components, which propagate at different group velocities in the medium, because the medium has dispersion. So dispersion means that it has refractive dependence of a refractive index on wavelength. So what happens to the laser pulse? So it has that each spectral component propagates at slightly different velocity, and so the pulse is spreading in time as it propagates in the medium. So actually the formulas look quite similar as for a Gaussian beam. Just here, instead of Rayleigh range, is the dispersion length, and this is G0 is group velocity dispersion coefficient. So how it's crucial again? So if we consider the pulse, which has a duration of 10 femtosecond, we can see how fast it's spreading in time as it propagates as well in a dispersive media. Also, what we can see, so if we are going to longer wavelength, to approaching the mid-infrared spectral range, so the diffraction and dispersion broadenings are much faster than for near-infrared or visible light. So, and dispersion looks similar to diffraction, but actually there is one big difference, because as we consider transparent media, so actually the group velocity dispersion at some point changes from normal to anomalous. So what it means, normal and anomalous? So normal dispersion, so it is for, let's say, near infrared and visible and ultraviolet wavelengths, is that the spectral components with lower frequencies, is a red spectral components, they propagate faster than blue. So actually the pulse develops, gets at the beginning you have white pulse, let's say composed of a white light spectrum. So here after some propagation you will see that the pulse front is red and the tail is blue, and so all the colors are within. For anomalous dispersion the situation is opposite. So the blue spectral components are faster, so the pulse front is blue and the pulse tail is red. And so to summarize what is the problem and what will happen because of diffraction and dispersion, so actually for many interactions, the quantity which defines the, let's say, your energy which is contained in a volume is actually the intensity, which is a power divided by area, or this is the energy, you have a beam width, and you have pulse duration. So what happens then, as we saw, for instance, 10 femtosecond pulse and 10 micron radius beam, so it actually after 1 millimeter of propagation, it has increases its spatial and temporal dimensions twice. This means that the intensity drops by a factor of 8, just in 1 millimeter of propagation. Therefore, so what is the goal and what is needed to do? Actually, it's a long-seeked goal for let's say, linear and nonlinear optics, is how to make the pulse propagate without diffraction and dispersion spreading in any medium. I mean transparent medium, there is no absorption. So, and actually, so this picture illustrates that, so we should kill somehow this diffraction and dispersion spreading of a pulse, or in real settings, you cannot compensate them exactly, but you should approach the subdiffractive or sub-dispersive propagation. And so this is actually the so-called the light bullet, and actually it requires simultaneous defeating of diffraction and dispersion. And so there are actually two different approaches. We are essentially different. One is linear, another is nonlinear. And so we provide completely different result. And as we see in the end, we will have a mix of linear and nonlinear at the very end as we finish. So linear approach is quite interesting, because actually it requires some tailoring of your pulse, of its shape in space and in time, so as that this pulse propagates without diffraction and dispersion. So, and these kind of wave packets are called propagation invariant wave packets. There are quite a lot of them invented, and some of them are already experimentally demonstrated. This is one demonstration, so-called Bessel-X pulses. And the idea of this is first, your beam has a profile like not a Gaussian, but like a Bessel beam, which is known as a non-diffracting beam. So for finite energy, it's non-diffracting for some finite distance. So first of all, you have a Bessel beam, and if you have a short pulse, this means that your Bessel beam is multicolor. So this means that you have many colors. And so the colors which are propagating faster, for instance, at that instance is red. So this red is made to propagate at larger angle. So if you look at the propagation axis, so you have that the projection of your group velocity on the propagation axis is then you have equal for blue and equal for red, just setting the angles. So how it happens? Actually, there are dispersion laws for media. One is normal, another is in anomalous dispersion. And so actually, you can do this. And the question is how this pulsed beam will look in space and in time. So the result is quite unexpected, I would say, and a little bit disappointing. Because in normal dispersion, you have wave packet, which looks like kind of this, so it's called an X wave. So because if you cut it by a central cut, you will see that you have some picture of X. And so the intensity actually is distributed over some kind of quite large space. But as we consider just the propagation of this central spot, we will see that this central spot propagates without diffraction and without dispersion. In anomalous dispersion, you have something like an onion-like structure. You have an intense peak, which is surrounded by some rings. These rings are not the rings of a Bessel beam, but these are rings in space and time domain. So this is a little bit different thing, because here we have, here is in space time. This is X, Y, and T. So to conclude, what are these propagation invariant wave packets? There are more. There are ARE packets and so on and so on. But actually to all of these, we are weakly localized wave packets. This means that just a fraction of energy is contained in this central non-diffracting and non-dispersing spot. The rest of energy, I would say about 90%, are just in this periphery, which with propagation, which continuously recreates you the short pulse. Actually, this pulse is not propagating, but it's recreated by the interference. So another approach is nonlinear. Nonlinear approach, actually, this picture is an illustration of really nonlinear approach. And so these light bullets in the nonlinear approach we are used to call spatiotemporal solitons. Spatiotemporal soliton, this means that you have a wave packet which is everywhere is the same. And so is that strongly localized because all the energy is just in the ball. There is no periphery. So everything is here. And the idea how to defeat diffraction and dispersion in the nonlinear regime, this means that you have in the medium some nonlinear effects, which, for instance, not for instance, but there are just two main nonlinear effects. This is self-focusing, which counteracts the diffraction, and self-phase modulation, which tries to keep the pulse in the same place. This is try to self-compress. So what are these effects, and what are origins of them? I will not talk deeply on the origins. I would just say very shortly that all the media, as we consider propagation of intense pulses, I mean intense, which is intensity is really high. So due to optical care effect, this leads to intensity-dependent index of refraction. In linear optics, the index of refraction for a given wavelength is a constant. Here, actually, if you have quite large intensity, you will have that index of refraction will change with intensity. So high intensity, high index of refraction. So this is just a very general picture showing all the media, because this nonlinear index of refraction is actually is a characteristic feature of all the materials. So here are all the materials, starting with wide band gap dielectric media, ending up with semiconductor. Of course, nonlinearity is different. So highest nonlinearity is in semiconductors, but we are not transparent, let's say, in the visible or near infrared spectral range. And so for wide band gap dielectrics, the nonlinear of refraction index of refraction is smallest, so this actually scales as band gap to -4. And so we actually are considering this media, not only just because we have low index of refraction, but we also have very high threshold for optical damage, because our intensities are such that, for instance, semiconductor media could be easily damaged. So, and wide band gap dielectrics not. So actually here we are speaking about this. And so the question is, how large is this N2? So this is example. This is sapphire, linear and nonlinear material, which is widely used in optics. So it has this nonlinear index of refraction, you see, is actually is very tiny. And if we have the input intensity, which equals to 10 to 12 watts per square centimeter, or it's 1 terawatt per square centimeter, so we have a change of the refractive index just in the order of 10 to minus 4. Seems very tiny change, but produces, as we will see, a great result. So, and just to see what is this result, first of all, in the space domain, so it's called the effect is called self-focusing. So this means what we have index of refraction. And if we have a laser beam, that the intensity is not uniform, but it is the highest intensity is in the beam center, and actually it, for a Gaussian beam, like a Gaussian function, drops to the edges. So, and this means that we have some modulation of the refractive index due to this additive, this N2 multiplied by intensity. So what happens then? So material starts to act as a positive lens. So we have at the input laser beam with a flat face front. So it enters the medium, which has nonlinear index of refraction, or we have intensity enough, which produces some effect. And so we have at the front gets bended. So the central part, which has the highest, which actually sees the highest index of refraction, is delayed with respect to the peripheral parts. So actually your front bends just like after passing the lens. The difference with a normal lens is that this lens is actually, with propagation, you have the focal distance of the lens, it gets shorter and shorter and shorter because intensity starts to increase. So, and it produces larger amount of refractive index change, and so on and so on. So this is the just picture of self-focusing, which is known for many years, just was discovered soon after invention of a laser. And so we can define also the critical power for self-focusing, so that's called power, which exactly balances the diffraction spreading. So, and this power is very, let's say the expression is very simple. And just to say, what is the power needed for, let's say, femtosecond laser pulses, actually, or for media which has nonlinear refractive index as sapphire, so all, they are all of the same order of magnitude. So the power is megawatts, few megawatts. Also depends on wavelength because it's lambda square. So, but this is in the order of from 1 to 10 of megawatts. So actually, if you take a femtosecond pulse, which has huge power, so this means that the pulse energy is few microjoules. That's nothing. It's any laser, any modern laser in the laboratory produces few microjoule pulses. So the next effect is related to change of the refractive index in time. So this means that we have a laser pulse which modulates the refractive index in time. So here the effect is looks similar by the origin, but it is completely different by the result. So what happens then? So just it is simple mathematics. It happens that it induces a nonlinear phase shift on the pulse. And so this is time-varying phase of a pulse produces a change of instantaneous frequency. And so this change of instantaneous frequency actually gives rise to spectral broadening. So the result is depicted here. So if you take that the leading front is on the here, on the left, yeah? If the leading front is on the left, the rising intensity produces you a frequency downshift. So you generate frequency components which are red, as just compared to the, of course, to the central frequency. And the tail, when you have dropping intensity, you are producing spectral components which are blue. So this is the very general picture. So, but it shows actually that the spectrum of the pulse, which propagates in the medium, gets broader and broader and broader. And so this accumulates with propagation. So there are actually two effects, which are considered that we can produce the light bullets. This means that, okay, we can exploit this frequency shift just to counteract the diffraction spreading and self-focusing to counteract the diffraction spreading. So, but the problem is that nothing is easy. So far, spatiotemporal solitons were demonstrated only in very complex, I would say complex media. So because you need actually some medium with some tailored properties because all these nonlinear effects, they accumulate the phase with propagation. So you should produce some different media. So actually one of them is an array of waveguides. And so if you launch into an array of waveguides, there are because of interaction, so this is the some example that if you increase the intensity, you have just your light propagates just in a single waveguide and the pulse gets very short here. So this is the result. And so what we consider, so what is needed to have in a bulk media? So this means that your medium is just a piece of some nonlinear material. It's not a waveguide, nothing. Just a simple piece of glass, piece of sapphire, whatever. So what to do then, and what is the problem? So for soliton, by definition, the soliton requires the exact balance between linear and nonlinear effects. But as nonlinear effects are phase accumulating, so we are getting stronger and stronger and stronger with propagation. So this is one problem. Another problem is multiphoton absorption. Because we have very high intensity, so what is the multiphoton absorption? It imposes that you have energy losses with propagation. You are losing continuously the energy, so it's no chance in just simple media to have a balance between linear and nonlinear effect. So what is the multiphoton absorption? As far as we are considering the wide band gap dielectric media, so actually our energy of a single photon is quite tiny. For instance, for 800 nanometers, this is titanium sapphire, wavelength of titanium sapphire laser, the photon energy is 1.55 electron volt. So dielectric media has a band gap, which is 5 electron volts and more, up to 10 or more for, let's say, fluoride materials. So how this multiphoton absorption is at work? So actually you are absorbing, for instance, 4 photons at once. And this is an intensity-depending effect. So if you have low intensity, actually you have no chance to see such effect. But if intensity becomes sufficiently high, the medium starts absorbing nonlinearly, so absorbing each time 4 photons. So and this multiphoton absorption rate scales as intensity over k, and so where k is this multiphoton absorption order. It's easy to calculate if you know band gap and your photon energy. So and if we add this effect to self-focusing and self-phase modulation and also linear effects. And if you let your pulse to propagate in bulk medium, so you will enter very interesting regime called femtosecond filamentation, which was discovered in 1995, not so long ago, just in modern times when you have already modern femtosecond lasers were produced. So you have this propagation, and so here is just a picture, which is a side view of a femtosecond filament which propagates in water. So this is a screenshot, and here is where just in water there are some particles which are scattering light just to see the light from the side. So don't be confused by the change of the color, because here actually these particles are so small, 20 nanometers, actually we are producing Rayleigh scattering, so we first scatter blue, afterwards we scatter. When the blue is scattered, we are scattering, let's say, other colors. Yeah, actually it looks like changing the color. Actually it's not true. It's already produces white light. So at the beginning you see nothing because it is the infrared laser pulse. So therefore you see nothing, and you will see when the filament appears, it is like that. Of course, this is a very short pulse here. We have a pulsed beam, so actually the short pulse is here. Here is just a time integrated picture. And so, femtosecond filamentation is what is interesting. It has a number of features which are universal for any media. So this means that solids, liquids, and gases, whatever the medium. Of course, the propagation scales and so on are different. Nonlinearities are different as well, but the features are the same. So, and these features are what we can say, this is subdiffractive propagation beyond the nonlinear focus we will talk about very soon. So we will also, we will see that there are different regimes of filamentations where you have pulse splitting on compression, and it depends on the sign of the group velocity dispersion. Another thing is intensity clamping. This means that it clamps the intensity because of multiphoton absorption and prevents the optical damage of a medium, even of a solid state medium, where damage is, if the damage occurs, it's permanent. So the medium is damaged. So it does not happen. And so spectral superbroadening, which is called supercontinuum generation, as we saw, you have a spectrum which is of white light. So also conical emission, this means that you have some emission of some colors which are propagating not on the propagation axis, but they are propagating at some angle. And what is, for instance, very useful for many applications of filaments is that they leave a narrow channel of free electron plasma behind the pulse. So, and actually this is the key effect, which is for material, laser processing, and so on and so on. So actually this is a very huge field of let's say fundamental science, as well as for let's say many applications in modern science, nonlinear optics, photonics, or whatever. So the nonlinear focus, when we have self-focusing, this is the if the power of our pulsed laser beam exceeds critical power for self-focusing, something happens here at the nonlinear focus. But mathematically, if you just write an equation, very simple equation, you will find that your beam should collapse. So intensity grows to infinity and the beam diameter goes to zero. Actually, this never happens. Something different is that here you have intensity increasing, so you start the multiphoton absorption to come into play. And so actually the multiphoton absorption clamps the intensity and prevents the beam from collapsing. So how this works, and in principle it's not so easy, let's say, to account how it works. So this is oversimplified picture that we see, okay, intensity increases and multiphoton absorption starts to absorb the top of a wave packet or top of a beam or top of a pulse. Actually, you should not forget that there is self-focusing is at the same time, and you have self-focusing of a beam which has a flat top. So this is the numerical simulation which shows you how the flat top beam is self-focusing. You will see that it is it has a shape of volcano, and afterwards you have growing very narrow and intense peak. So this is an experimental confirmation what happens there. And so afterwards, if we look more precisely, we will see that our input Gaussian beam by multiphoton absorption is reshaped into a Bessel-like beam. It's not Bessel beam, but it's Bessel-like. It has a very narrow central core and some ring structure. And if we see what happens then beyond the nonlinear focus, that the beam is still diffracting, but the rate of the diffraction is much lower than for a Gaussian beam. So, and this is because it develops this Bessel-like spatial profile. We have some measurements at some distances. We see that it's always the same. We have a central peak, and we have this ring structure. So this means that for spatiotemporal soliton, as we defined, that this is an ideal light bullet. So this never happens because of nonlinear absorption, because it reshapes your beam completely. So the beam is gets completely different. So what happens then if you increase the power? You are increasing, let's say, by times for P critical. So you will see this is single nonlinear focus. There are afterwards, it may focus again, may focus three times, and so on and so on. So as long as you have more and more energy, so your propagation is like this. So the beam is not, the diameter of the beam is not constant, but is something like this. So now we should move to what happens in in time. For the, what happens, so the beam is reshaped in space. So what happens in time? So in time, as long as we consider normal group velocity dispersion, so the action of self-phase modulation and normal group velocity dispersion, this means that at the pulse front, you are generating red spectral components, which are faster than the blue, which are generated on the pulse tail. The pulse should get spreading all the time. So that's simple, but this never happens. So the result is that your pulse actually is not dispersing, but your pulse is splitting, because also there is nonlinear absorption which acts on the pulse top. So it destroys the pulse and it makes the pulse to split into two parts. So here are the pulse, so this is propagation distance, and you see the input pulse is actually not visible in this intensity scale, but you will see afterwards there is a splitting at nonlinear focus and two pulses here are created. At larger power, you have with every nonlinear focus, you have producing a new pulse splitting event. So how it looks like in the real measurement? So this is the input pulse. It's how it looks at the nonlinear focus. And then you have a pulse splitting, and so you see that there is an energy which is getting distributed in space, which is a, let's say, first ring of a Bessel beam, because here is an isointensity plot, so we can just show one part. And afterwards, these pulses are getting away, and this ring recreates a pulse, which is again in the center, and it, if you have a power enough, if its power is over critical power for self-focusing, it will split again. So this is the picture. So if we have anomalous group velocity dispersion, so that it's, let's say it's in this wavelength range, so we are going, we are approaching mid-infrared. So action of self-phase modulation and group velocity dispersion is now opposite. So this means that by self-phase modulation, you generate red spectral components at the pulse front, but we are slower than the blue, which are generated at the tail. So the pulse should compress. So now to real media, what is needed, what kind of wavelengths and kind of media are needed to achieve this anomalous group velocity dispersion. There are just very simple media, few silica, sapphire, calcium fluoride, and yttrium aluminum garnet. So you will see that the anomalous group velocity dispersion starts from few silica is from 1.3 and goes to 1.7 for yttrium aluminum garnet. So if you choose wavelength around 2 microns, so you will have almost in all the wide band gap dielectric media, you have anomalous group velocity dispersion. So how it works? This is the side views of plasma-induced luminescence. In normal dispersion, we see this focusing cycles, which are repeating. Yeah? And so this is a quite similar power, but we see the filament, which is extremely long in anomalous group velocity dispersion. This means that your pulse has the intensity, which is quite constant over propagation. So the intensity, which means quite constant over propagation, means that your pulse is not spreading, and your beam is not spreading in space. So not in space, not in time. So okay, this is the numerical simulation. It shows you that actually your pulse at some distance at nonlinear focus is compressed and propagates without changing its duration. The beam diameter is also almost constant, and so this is the first measurement. We was input 14 femtosecond, output was 20. So how to characterize now these pulses? it was just what I showed was very simple characterization. So here is as well. We can see, okay, the spectrum gets broader, the pulse gets shorter. So, but this is not enough since we have a wave packet which is maybe quite complex. And so pulse width and spectrum, we just tell just one part of the story. So maybe more advanced characterization is so-called frequency resolved optical gating. But it, as well, there is no information on the space. Here is just information on time and on spectrum. And so not enough. So what we have made, we invented some three-dimensional imaging, which actually takes advantages of both of these methods, but we also are able to measure the pulse in space at the same time. So this is some example that you can input Gaussian beam is like a ball, so you are measuring just taking very short pulse and you're slicing your pulse by very short pulse, like a strobe, as in the morning you heard about this very, very fast spectroscopy of electron motion or whatever. So here you just slice another pulse with another pulse by generating, for instance, some frequency. Yeah? So, and the pulse could be whatever. So the experimental setup is actually quite simple. Just you need two optical parametric amplifiers. One is just usual optical parametric amplifier, which produces a tunable light, which actually is injected into nonlinear medium. And so whatever comes out is sampled by non-collinear optical amplifier, which produces very short 25 femtosecond pulse. And so you are slicing, changing the time delay, and then you rebuild the pulse how it looks like. So here, yeah. And so we made this complete characterization. For instance, the light bullet, which is formed by 100 femtosecond pulses at 1.8 micron in sapphire. So here is the spatiotemporal intensity profiles. Of course, we are measuring in 3D, but for simplicity, we are showing just one dimension is space, and another dimension here below is time. It dropped somewhere, so sorry. So in space and time, so we see for the Gaussian pulse, we have a ball-like structure, so which transforms into something quite strange. You have an intense core, which has some kind of rings which are in space, in space-time. So not in space, but in space-time. So then, from this image, you can actually make temporal integration, put everything, and so to see what is the spatial intensity distribution. So here is a Gaussian beam, and afterwards we will see that for these bullets we have Bessel, it looks like a Bessel beam. And finally, we also made another characterization, which is called that which is angularly resolved spectra. So we are measuring spectrum and with angular resolution. This means that we are just looking how the spectral components at which angles are propagating. So we will see that the spectrum is quite interesting. It has some kind of just a half of O shape. But the new spectral components which appear, we are propagate not on the axis, not only on the axis, but also off the axis. And so summarizing this, so we can see that, okay, these spatiotemporal light bullets, which are generated in simple bulk media, are quite peculiar objects, which consist of this high-intensity localized core, actually, which carries the self-compressed pulse, and so a delocalized, or this periphery, which carries the most of the energy, and which is, when it propagates, it continuously refills your pulse, recreates all the peak all the time. So what we found that actually these objects had a name of nonlinear O waves, which was numerically shown that the pulse should look like this. It has the spectrum of a ring shaped and the spatial profile like a Bessel beam. So actually this is nothing more than nonlinear O wave. So which is actually the solution, localized and stationary solution of a nonlinear Schrödinger equation in the nonlinear media with nonlinear losses, which are induced by multiphoton absorption. So we have these, so these light bullets have very few, very unexpected features, and we are completely different from spatiotemporal solitons. So we made a simple experiment just to see how we propagate in free space. So here is how we propagate in sapphire, it's focuses, and afterwards it's in propagates in subdiffractive manner, just the beam dimensions are growing very slowly, and so the pulse duration is almost constant. So if we cut the nonlinear medium here and let it propagate in the air, if it was a spatiotemporal soliton, it should diffract very fast because it's like a Gaussian beam. So the diffraction for the infrared is, you see, very fast. While in time, there is no dispersion in air. At least for this kind of spectrum which we produced. So it should not change the duration. So we measured the following. So this is everything in the middle. So the diffraction is suppressed, but it has a dispersion by propagating in free space. So the question is why? The answer is here. If we look at this angular spectrum, so we see that these spectral components, which are distributed over some angles, we keep the pulse localized in the dispersive medium. But if it comes outside, this dispersion law has changes. And so this distribution is no longer keeps the pulse together if it propagates in free space. So therefore, it is getting the diffraction broadening. Yeah? So this is the interesting feature. Another is interesting feature is self-healing in a nonlinear medium. Self-healing is an intrinsic property of a Bessel beam because the peak is recreated every time by interference. So you can block the central part of a Bessel beam. After some short propagation distance, it will be recreated. So we made experiment like this. So we in the first crystal, we generate the bullet, and we put a beam stopper, or just a damaged spot, which is like this, 20 micron. And so then we let it propagate in another nonlinear medium, just looking what happens there. So it seems that, okay, after the first medium, we have a light bullet, which has this kind of shape, and stopper acts like this. It cuts the central part, because here is time, so we just cut in space. And so this is the result when it propagates in another nonlinear medium. We will see after some propagation, it recreates this peak, which contains the short pulse. So this means that not only like a Bessel beam, which recreates the big peak in space, but here it recreates also the pulse in time. So we have a pulsed beam, which is very, we can say, it's extremely robust object, because you have perturbation. You can also perturb the periphery. It also will be, nothing happens. So this is very robust object. So you cannot kill it so easily. And even if you have its nonlinear losses, high intensity, so it all the time it will be recreating. So what's more interesting, it could self-heal also in free space propagation. So just propagation in air where it has sub-dispersive propagation and so sub-diffractive propagation and some dispersion. So here is the same. We just removed another crystal and let the bullet propagate some distance in air. So we see it's diffracting, dispersing, but rebuilds the peak. So that's quite an interesting feature as well. So what's more, maybe it's a more complicated topic. It's as we talk about very short pulses, carrier envelope phase, this means that how the electric field is positioned below the pulse envelope. So if you have unstable, it could be any combination for any subsequent laser pulse because it generates. So in principle here, we have a carrier envelope phase which is stable, which is produced by an optical parametric amplifier. So what we have shown here, we've shown that light bullets as well, we have stable carrier envelope phase. So this is a measurement of so-called F2F interferometric measurement. You have interference pattern, which is stable in time. And actually, as you see, this is 113 milliradian, just a drift of the carrier envelope phase. So what's more, these features are universal to any media. So there are two different media, sapphire and fused silica. As we see in propagation, we cannot distinguish where is in sapphire, where is in fused silica. Of course, there are very tiny, because nonlinearity is different, dispersion is a little bit different. So there are tiny differences in pulse duration and the beam diameter, but actually it's the same. It goes to, when you form light bullet, it has a shape, which is a O-shaped, so-called, this is a hot spot inside, and ring structure in space and time. Even more, if you change the wavelength, we add more anomalous group velocity dispersion, or we shift the input wavelength more to 2.25 microns. So we have at the beginning something, some transient regime is very interesting. Something happens there, but at the very end, we still see the same structure. So afterwards, whatever happens before, so actually this light bullet is produced like an object of what we see already. And so just to, at the very end, so what we are talking, what to do with these light bullets actually. So, okay, there are objects, we found how to kill diffraction and dispersion. So, but what is interesting, we are producing a very broad spectrum, not only just around the carrier wavelength, which we are discussing before, but we are producing extremely broad spectral width, so it is called supercontinuum generation. And this supercontinuum is actually spatially and temporally coherent white light radiation. So white light, this is, of course, as we talk about the visible spectral range. So this is supercontinuum generated with a green pulse, which propagates in water, so propagate and creates a spectrum from blue to red. In more general case, the supercontinuum actually is, it could be as well in the near infrared, mid infrared, and so as I show, it covers a huge interval of the optical spectrum. So, for instance, here is supercontinuum spectrum in sapphire with 800 nanometer pulses. So we will see, okay, that it mostly broadens to the blue side. This is the input pulse, this is the output pulse. So we have actually the spectral broadening is hundreds of times or even more. So what happens, this also happens in the range of normal group velocity dispersion where you have pulse splitting. So actually your continuum in time domain, your supercontinuum has two pulses which propagate, which has a little bit different carrier frequencies and propagate of different velocities. So as far as we move to anomalous group velocity dispersion, so there are supercontinuum in different media. This is, of course, the visible part which you can percept just putting a screen after your nonlinear medium. But so this is a full spectrum, which is just allowed to, our spectrometer allowed just to measure up to 2.5 microns. Actually, numerical simulations show that this spectrum goes to up to 4 microns. So this means that you have spectrum, which is from the from blue to mid-infrared. So actually, it's a huge spectrum. In different media, of course, these spectra are quite different. But anyway, as compared to normal group velocity dispersion, the spectra are much broader. So, and this measurement just shows you how this light bullet and supercontinuum are related. So this is the input, and so here is the nonlinear focus. You will see that the spectral broadening here occurs. This is in infused silica, and so you have a light bullet formed. So you see that, again, already you have a supercontinuum and light bullet. So supercontinuum generation is at nonlinear focus where the light bullet is formed. And so experiment of our colleagues. So we have investigated supercontinuum generation with 3-micron pulses. So actually the measurement is getting more and more difficult because you should use at least 4 detectors which should be calibrated to measure such kind of spectrum. Also we cannot percept all the spectrum at all. And so what is interesting, actually that numerical simulations show that actually your pulse also should self-compress to a single optical cycle. This is like, this is from 70 femtosecond to 7.2, this is 10 times compression. This means you have a pulse of a single optical cycle in the mid-infrared. And just to conclude about these light bullets, which are generated by self-focusing of ultra-short pulse laser beams in bulk dielectric media with anomalous group velocity dispersion. So we can say, okay, that we take advantage of both linear and nonlinear localization mechanisms because we look like a linear light bullets, but in other part we look like a nonlinear. So because we need nonlinearity to be produced. So therefore it's very interesting. Of course, in some sense, it's a little bit disappointing. Everyone wants to have a spatiotemporal soliton where all the energy is concentrated in your single ball. Here is not the case. But, okay, so we have basic properties of so-called polychromatic nonlinear Bessel beams, and so exhibit a number of unique features, for instance, subdiffractive and subdispersive propagation in the medium. Dispersive propagation in free space, this is, of course, you should account for if you want to translate and use your bullets somewhere in some other experiment. So also we show exceptional robustness against perturbation. So this means we have this property like a Bessel beam of self-healing. So stable carrier envelope phase. A lot of experiments require that your pulse should have stable carrier envelope phase. For instance, high harmonic generation or whatever. And also ultra-broadband supercontinuum emission. And at the very end, I would like to thank my colleagues, Professor Gintaras Valiulis, Gintaras Tamošauskas, my former students, which already defended their PhD thesis, is Donatas Majus and Julius Draginavičius, my present students. So also my collaborators from Ecole Polytechnique of Center of Theoretical Physics, Professor Anok Varon, and postdoc Vytautas Jukna, and also Professor Daniela Faccio from here at Watt University. So thank you for your attention.
Solution or just because you said it's self-healing. At some point there again will be a maximum intensity in the middle, which would again cause focusing and again cause multiperturbation absorption. Will it disappear or can it propagate indefinitely?
Okay, so yes, I got your question. Yes, after self-healing, okay, the problem is that you have finite energy and so you're propagation, this because it propagates, it's not killing the diffraction, for instance, completely. It is subdiffractive. The propagation is subdiffractive. So when you have self-healing, okay, it gives you, let's say, a new boost of energy into this central peak, which is contains an ultra-short pulse. But it is not longer propagation. Because you are losing energy with a beam stopper, but it shows you that it is just a fraction of your energy which is contained in your very short pulse, which is not non-dispersing, non-diffracting. Actually, all your energy is outside, and this outside recreates. When its reservoir is empty, so actually, it eventually would disperse and diffract. So that's the end of the bullet. But anyway, if you calculate, if you see for a Gaussian pulse, for instance, what is the diffraction and what is the dispersion length, this propagation exceeds by many times the usual diffraction and dispersive length.
Okay.